all for coming to the Battelle training. I think you'll find it informative, and the reason that we're rolling this out is because we started using developmental delay, and hopefully you're all aware of that and sat through that training back in the summer. This assessment can be used with kids from birth all the way through age 7, so that's why we have a nice mix of people here today. So the first thing I want you to do is just get into your kids on the table. Just look at what's in the tackle box, what's in the blue bag, and we're going to talk about what all you have. Yeah, so there's a lot to this kid. Just to give you some perspective, our birth to 5 teachers lug this thing out of the building. They put it in their trunk. They get it out of their trunk. They lug it up, 5 sets of steps sometimes, into a teeny tiny apartment onto a really dirty floor. So when you're lugging this thing in your school, just think about that a little bit. Because I know it's a lot. It is. It's 2 big bags. People always look at me and say, are you going fishing? And so we kind of are, but so there's a lot of manipulatives, but one of the reasons I had you get in there was because once you get familiar with where things are and what's in there, it seems more manageable. So like someone said, there are booklets for each of the domains. They look like this. These are handy. You will need these every time you test. And there's 5 domains. So you have the adaptive, personal, social, communication, motor, and cognitive, and then underneath each of those are subtests. You do have to administer each subtest to get a standard score for each of the domains, and we'll get into that here in a little bit. You also need to administer all 5 developmental domains if you're considering DD. And just as a side note, if your speech therapist is testing, you wouldn't have to test communication. If for some reason your OT or PT was testing, you wouldn't need to test your motor. But the adaptive, social, and cognitive are pretty much standard for us as teachers. So some testing prep. Again, there's a lot here. So you want to make sure that you have all contents of the kit. Don't think about, well, I'm testing a 6-year-old, so I think they're only going to need these materials or this domain. Take it all with you, because you never know when that child is going to not quite perform up to what you expect, or will perform beyond your expectations, and then you're having to get into different testing items. Of course, find a space that limits distractions, that's quiet, comfortable, typical standardized testing procedures. Have incentives for the student, and have a way to build rapport. For our little ones, the 3s and 4s, bubbles are always a fun way to build that rapport quickly. And then prepare your testing materials, just like we're doing for IEP meetings and other standardized testing. You have a student workbook, and then you also have your booklet. And so just having some of that basic information filled out on the front, especially if you're testing multiple students, it helps keep things clear from the onset of testing. And have a plan. You know your kids. We'll get into how you have to test in what order, but have a plan as far as what you think might happen. This doesn't have to be done in one day, in one session, so you can split it up. So let's look at, if you have someone on your table, find the adaptive domain. It's this one. And you're going to find the SC35. We're going to break this down a little bit. So each page kind of has the same layout, which is very helpful. It helps you find things much very quickly. So your domain area is always at the top. So we know we have the adaptive booklet, so we're testing the adaptive domain. The subdomain, or the subtest, is how I reference it, is self-care. The SC stands for self-care, so again, a nice little clue in. And then, of course, you have the behavior, what you're testing, and if you need any materials. This is a nice one because you don't need any materials. But then you have the standard procedure. And this one, again, only has one standard procedure. There's actually 3. So So we'll get into what the other two are. But this one is an interview. And so you're going to, the child takes a bath or shower without assistance. You guys are probably going to come across this one pretty frequently because you're dealing with older children. Are you going to be able to ask the teacher that? No. So you're going to have to be having some interaction with your parents. And then here's specifically what you say. Does your child take a bath or shower by himself or herself? And then if they say yes, how much help does the child need to prepare for and take a bath or shower and to dry himself or herself? You're not going to deviate from these standardized directions or questions. Anything in bold is what you're specifically supposed to say. What we come across is sometimes the parent doesn't always understand the question, so you can explain the question a little bit if that happens. This one's pretty straightforward, though. I think they're going to understand that. But you really want to keep to the bold print for what you said. So then it always ends with how you scored. So two would be without assistance, including getting the bath or shower ready. One with some help, for example, running the water. And zero with a great deal of assistance. And so if you find your recording booklet, adaptive is the very first section, and self-care is the very first subsection. And so you're going to find SC35, which is the very last one. And you would mark on your testing booklet a 2, 1, or 0. What you also notice next to that is it only has, if you look at the very top, it has score, then procedure. And so next to procedure, it'll tell you how you can do that. And it'll only have the I because interview is our only option. So just another little key in to help you know what the standardized procedure is. Any questions about this? Every page is really laid out like this, so it's a nice guidance tool, and it means that you really want this booklet out as you're doing it, because it has all of your directions.
One question, and I don't know if I'd ask, can this be done in different languages?
We have done it with an interpreter.
Oh.
So you have an interpreter, and you note that in your assessment, results because sometimes that language doesn't always interpret exactly, so it's still a standardized procedure, but you want to make note of that.
Would you suggest that the singular students do it and they're showing the language sentence mark, and would you try English and French?
You want to look at, is the student an EL student? And really your EL team should be able to help you make that decision. With our younger kids.
They usually wait until after midterm, before night.
Yeah. And that's been a little bit of an ongoing issue. So keep us in the loop if that comes up. I know with our little ones, when they're not in school, we're going with the primary language that they're exposed to on a consistent basis. So for them, it's their home language because they're not really getting instruction in English. Okay, any other questions about this page? So how do you know where to start? So if you look in your booklet, and we'll stay here on adaptive, you have age anchoring starting points. So 0 to 11 months, and so on, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. Those are suggested starting points. You don't necessarily have to start there. If you think the child is performing at a lower level, you can start lower. Just be careful. You don't want to overtest yourself. Don't be starting up in the infancy level if you know that they have some of these skills. And certainly don't start higher. At least always start at their age. On this standardized assessment, you have 3 correct or your basal, 3 incorrect or your ceiling. You don't have to finish a page like when Carol was presenting the Wilcott, like there's none of that. So 3 right, 3 wrong, and those are your basals and ceilings. you can work backwards. So if you start at 4 years and they're not achieving three, you can come back and start at three. You can work your way back. And then whenever you do hit your basal, everything is scored too ahead of that. You don't have to go in and fill in your bubbles, but you at least have to, when you score it, know that everything ahead of that was two. And then really make sure that you're using, in your booklet, you're using these guidelines, because that'll really help clear up, especially for some of the interview, the less direct observation or interaction you have with a child. That 2, 1, and 0 provides a lot of information in your booklet as far as how to score it. So, as far as the order, when possible, administer the sub-tests of the domains in order. So, due to more engagement with the child during motor and cognitive, that's typically where I start. You can start with adaptive, but a lot of that is teacher and parent interview. So you can start with cognitive, but if you start with cognitive, you really want to try and do all three subtests in order. So attention and memory, then reasoning and academic skills, and then perception and concepts. However, and we've all met these kiddos that are really struggling and they really need that quick change up of activities, at least complete a subtest before you move on to another subtest. So oftentimes I might do one subtest in cognitive, and they're just really struggling, and so maybe gross motor is the next place I go and get a subtest out of there, because they just need to get up and move, and that's the easiest way to do that. Okay. Any questions about that? So you can do the domains in any order. Best practice is subdomains or subtests in order. And then your last resort is if students aren't attending and aren't performing, well, not performing, but aren't attending, to switch up from subtest to subtest. So like I said, there's three ways that you can test an item. One is interview with a parent or teacher. Observation or structured with a child. You want to pay very close attention to this, because if structured is an option, you really want to be, you really want to be doing that option, because we want to get what the student can do on a one-time assessment. But then you can also take information that you have from the classroom and supplement that. When it's a skill that would be demonstrated at school and not a direct interaction, please observe or ask the teacher. But there are some items that you really are going to have to talk to the parent about, and you'll be able to figure that out as you get used to the test. The adaptive domain is a big area, because we don't see all those adaptive skills at school. The social area lends itself more to the school setting. And really just use that professional discretion. And when you look at, again, if you open up to the adaptive, you'll see another clue in, is it'll show you, is it structure, is it observation, or is it interview? And so it'll show you next to each one. But then again, if you have your booklet open, it'll also tell you the procedure that you can do. So a lot of kind of self-checks available with this assessment. If structured is the only option, and like one testing item is count as high as you can, and the child gets to 5 and stops, but you know you've heard that child count to 20 or to 30 in class, you need to score it, whatever just happened. But then you can report additional items within your testing report, anecdotally, not through scoring. We really are looking for that consistency of skills and that generalization. So if students, we know this is a one-time snapshot, but we also know that if students can't perform when we're asking them to, which is difficult for most of our students, we want to be able to reflect that in the scoring to better support whatever our child's needs are.